come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale. And this is the podcast where we keep it classy whenever we can, but not always. I'm your host, Mike McStay.
Not always.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for emphasizing that, Matt. Thank you. If you clearly did not know, this is my channel. I'm Mike McStay. Hello there. First off, I would introduce you to my brotherhood and sisterhood of cinema here, the bros and sisters of cinema here. First up, we've got Matt Brunet, also known as Animat.
You know, the funny thing is, you Americans will never know the true glory of a donut from Tim Hortons.
I guess not.
I have a Tim Hortons, asshole. Don't you start.
Yeah, but that's an American Tim Hortons.
Oh, whatever. Screw you.
I'm never going to be able to experience a donut from there. Or a sausage roll from Greg's.
Do you know the beauty of a double-double?
No, what? But I probably will discover that someday.
Exactly.
Up next is our temporary female co-host, Devin Cook.
Hey. I'm glad to be back again. I don't know how long it's been since I passed on, but... I'm here, I'm big, and I'm plump and beautiful.
Maybe yeah, not she's blonde, got but her not. Mickey jams on.
I always wear Mickey, come on. Mickey's awesome. Screw you all.
Hey.
Oh boy.
Next up is James Sullivan, who knows Homitude.
Tonight's broadcast is... brought to you by London Shakur Taylor.
Oh yeah.
Born Wednesday, September 28th. And
yeah, the puppies.
And his brother London Dean Taylor.
Little puppies.
My new godchildren.
Aww. Uncle James.
Oh, that Uncle James.
Uncle James.
Uncle James.
Oh, and here's a better picture, actually, too.
Uncle James is so sweet.
Mm-hmm. And since Morgan is away on his seasonal job at Witch's Wood, I figure I bring in a guest co-host to come along for this little adventure on this episode.
Oh, he's at Witch's Wood. Oh.
Yeah, that's why I couldn't come tonight. Yeah. Yeah, so he's back at it. We have somebody from the United Kingdom, Steph Felton.
Hello, my lovelies. How are we doing? Yes, I'm from a YouTube from the UK, but unfortunately, if anybody's thinking like, oh, she's a British YouTuber, so she's probably up there with Casper Lee and Joe Stark, hang out with them. No, definitely not. But yeah, I have my own nostalgia review on
she's
my channel.
She's neighbours with Mike J.
Yeah, I have my own massage review series on my YouTube channel. I do vlogs, I do tags, challenges. If I have an idea for a video, it goes up. And recently I did do a video on my channel announcing this particular podcast, so go and check it out. And I would promote the radio show as well, but I don't do it anymore. Oh. Never mind. I know, sad times. So yeah, so that's me. I'm cute, I squee at animals, especially kittens, and I may or may not have a crush on Devin.
Enough said.
I've had alcohol.
Tonight, we are going to revisit an old topic from the past. We're going to revisit the topic of musicals. Last time we've done... our musical discussion, it was James, Matt, and I, and that was, God, that was 3 years ago. 3 years ago, and it's time to go back into the genre and talk about some musicals. And since Matthew has won the cookie challenge, he gets the honor to talk about his film first, which should be very interesting, especially the girl to his right, according to the video.
Really? Oh, that's my prize? That's it? Oh, that sucks. Anyways, so considering that we are talking about musicals, the one that I decided to do is pretty much what is currently the biggest musical of the decade. And some people could say, oh, you got to talk about Hamilton? No. Why am I hearing an echo?
Because somebody unplugged their earplug.
That would be stuck.
All right.
Yes.
Sorry.
We are experiencing technical difficulty.
All right. Hold on.
Yeah. Much better. Anyways, as I was saying, might as well talk about the biggest musical of the decade, and I'm, of course, referring to Frozen. And, you know, it's funny considering how huge Frozen has been now. It's one of those movies at this point that a lot of people have seen and much more know the music. And I'm sure there are a lot more people who know about Let It Go before that they know about Frozen. But let's try to take a look into the movie itself. Of course, as you may know, it is loosely based on the Snow Queen fairy tale, and it has been more than 70 years in which Walt Disney and the Disney Company tried to turn that into an actual musical. But with what we got now, it was actually, you know, it's something that is highly fascinating. In the original fairy tale, the Snow Queen is often portrayed as a villain. But in here, in Frozen, the Snow Queen, Elsa, is actually more as a child who feels, or like someone who feels like they have a curse. Like they got this supernatural power, but they don't know how to control it. They don't know how to use it. And at that point, when their parents passed away and she has to take the throne, like, the stress was so much into her, down to the point that she broke down, she revealed her powers, and she decided to run away. And thus came the song, Let It Go, and then suddenly she feels great about being, you know, singular, about being solo and building her own castle and be, you know, in her own fortress. And that's mostly the element with Elsa, and of course you got the other parts as well with her Elsa's sister Anna trying to go and try to save Elsa, to bring her back to Arendelle and to fix things up that apparently it would, like, what? Everybody,
welcome to Cinema Royale, where our parents interrupt us in the middle of the podcast. Hey, it wasn't my dad this time.
No. Alright, anyways, as I was saying, so also we got the part with Anna, and she teams up with this pretty much this ice guy named Kristoff with his reindeer Sven, and they also team up with a talking snowman named Olaf, and their quest is to go and bring bring Elsa back to Arendelle, fix up the curse. But at the same time, they have to go save Anna because apparently there was an accident that involved her getting her heart being a bit iced, and she's like slowly but surely dying, and her hair turns white and all that kind of stuff. Now let's, considering we were talking about a musical, let's talk about the music itself. And of course, we got the it's funny because when I think about it, like the most popular songs that everybody knows about, it's pretty much the ones sung by either Anna or Elsa. And I'm talking about Do You Want to Build a Snowman?, Let It Go, For the First Time in Forever, and Love is an Open Door. Those are the main songs that everybody knows about. And but funny enough, honestly for me, like the other songs that nobody really does talk about, like I actually enjoy them as well. Whether it be In Summer with Olaf or Fixer Upper, that I find to be a little underrated, actually. Like, maybe it's a dumb song, but I actually do end up singing it a few times.
In Summer, like, that's how has its little fan base. Yes, I agree.
Yeah, I think that's how you know you can find a true Frozen fan. Like, a regular Frozen fan will know all the lyrics to Let It Go. A true Frozen fan knows all the lyrics to Fix Her Upper. But the songs themselves are actually, they're very well done. They are provided by Robert and Kristen Anderson Lopez, a great dynamic team. They have previously done work for Disney before. These include Finding Nemo the Musical at Disney's Animal Kingdom. They began working on animated features with the 2011 Winnie the Pooh animated film. And since then, their next one is going to be the 2018 film Gigantic. But the songs are actually definitely fantastic. They can range from being fun with In Summer and Fixer Upper. And then there are those that are more like the overall tone is definitely uplifting, and it's especially viewable in songs like For the First Time in Forever, and also Love is an Open Door, which is like the standard love song in there. And I've seen a lot of people trying to do like they can do duos, and like it's a little tricky to try to pull it off. But of course, the infamous songs, like, of course, Do You Want to Build a Snowman has pretty much been turned into a meme. And that's mostly made to be, like, a story-driven kind of story. This is the kind that we see a transition over the years with Anna's relationship with Elsa, and pretty much showing their childhood of how it was, where Anna wants to go out and have fun, while Elsa wants to stay inside because she doesn't want to harm her. But then there's the song, Let It Go. And this is truly the song that formed Frozen to what it is today. And I don't mean in pop culture, I even mean the movie itself. Because for the longest time, Elsa was the villain of the feature. They don't know what, like, and they don't know what to do with it. They didn't feel like this is the right direction. It wasn't until Bob and Kristen wrote the song Let It Go. And they decided to change a little bit of the character to be more of a sympathetic kind of character, where instead of like the kind of character you're supposed to love to hate, like a regular villain, she's the kind where you feel very sympathetic. Like, she doesn't want these powers. She feels, you know, that like for her, it's kind of a curse, and it takes her away from being a normal person. So that's why she feels hurt, she feels sad about it. And with that song, it's like she finally decided, you know what, screw it, this is who I am, so I am going to be me. So this is pretty much the kind of song that even though you have your differences that really do separate yourself from the other crowd, and it could be like, you know, it could like in a way you see it as a curse and it cripples you down, but like with Let It Go, it's the kind of like a realization, it's like, you know what, this makes me me. And it's at that point that they had to rewrite the entire script to go around with Let It Go, and that's how we got Frozen today. And that's pretty much the biggest song, down to the point that it's an Oscar-winning song, in fact. Frozen did end up winning 2 Oscars, and of course... And of course, it has now officially become the highest-grossing animated feature. It's the second animated feature to surpass $1 billion, and now it has reached up to $1.27 billion, which is a pretty hard task to defeat. I mean, of course, in recent years we are seeing many movies trying to get up there, and the closest one so far, they can range from either there's like Minions, and then there's Finding Dory, Zootopia, and I think like Secret Life of Pets is getting up there, but they have yet to reach up the ranks of Frozen, and it seems like a record that it could possibly hold on for a while, because it's such a huge phenomenon. This film, along with Despicable Me, is pretty much the most marketable and most successful animated feature there is out there. And even nowadays, Disney is planning to go and make not only a sequel, but they want to make a Broadway musical out of it. And, you know, what I find to be pretty good is that they don't have a release date yet, because what they're doing is that they're trying to craft the entire setting, whether it be, like, they want to craft the Broadway musical or the sequel. Like, they want to make sure those are good first before they can fully get to work into it. And that, honestly, I find is admirable, and probably the best way you can do a sequel is that you can't work until there's a deadline. Just work until it is good, you know? And that's pretty much my whole spiel on Frozen. Oh, but actually, I just realized something. The one criticism that I do have in terms of the songs of Frozen is that they are badly placed. And that's probably my biggest criticism with the movie as well, because it definitely feels like the grand majority of all the songs, like almost all the songs, they were placed in the first half. Like, at one point, it feels like they jump from one song to the next, and then suddenly, when the second act comes in, I think, like, after Fixer Upper, that's it. There's no more. And that's pretty much my problem with it, is that the order is pretty bad. Sometimes it feels way too much, and then some other times it just feels like they just stop. That's it. There's no more.
I hadn't quite thought of it that way, but yeah.
Yeah. I will want to apologize for the disturbance in technologies, because I was going to grab something.
It's all good.
And it was this.
Aww.
He's a Yonatai! And not only is it an Olaf, but look! And the figures! Disneyland Paris!
Oh, yeah, I got it back in April when I went.
Oh, shit! Sorry, Disney! But yeah, I got it back in April when I went to Paris with my sister, and like, there was a whole stall dedicated to Frozen, oddly enough, in Adventureland. You'd think it'd be in Fantasyland, but. But yeah.
In summer.
Really?
I'm going to have to say this now, Matt. When Mike told me what your choice was going to be, I squeed so hard, because I have to admit, I love Frozen. I mean, I don't love it as much as the Renaissance period of the 90s. I mean, nothing can beat those. But I love the merchandise. I love the songs. I love Olaf the bit, because he likes warm hugs. And I have to admit, I really like Anna. She's definitely a princess that I can relate to. I mean, pretty much with Anna, if you took me, make me skinnier, prettier, make me hit the high notes, and then boom, you got Anna. Also, turn my hair ginger and put a highlight in it, and then you very much got Anna, because, you know, she is definitely someone you can relate to.
Yeah, because... Well, I was going to say, she has a character I can relate to. Well, for me, I've always felt a lot more of a connection to Elsa. The character who felt like her powers were a curse, her life was like she was meant to be alone. In a lot of ways, I felt the same way, and I still kind of have struggled with that from time to time. I mean, I sort of compare my arm to Elsa's powers, really. It really is kind of that feeling like it's a curse, like I dealt with that all my life. Dealing with feeling like that. So I understand completely. Like, I really admire the film. I admire the film really for its characters. I love the songs, don't get me wrong. All the songs that Matt mentioned are very good. I love Fixer Upper. I love Let It Go. I love First Time in Forever. Love is an Open Door. I even like the song Frozen Heart, the intro song. When you think about it...
that's another one, Frozen Heart.
The one that everyone forgets about. Oh yeah, they sang in the beginning.
Funny enough, I actually use Frozen, like, during the winter time. That's the song I always sing every time I go out shoveling. It's the best.
You know, why don't you get a flamethrower, dude? Let's melt that shit.
Yeah, but then you can't build snowmen.
Stop. Oh yeah, James. Stop!
James, you laugh, but you don't know the life with snow, man. It's fun, beautiful when it's Christmas, but afterwards, my God, it's a pain in the friggin' butt.
Thank you. Thank you, Matt.
And definitely what you were saying, Matt, like, with the songs, it definitely feels like you're in a musical. It's almost got that vibe, like, The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Like, and the best example, what I thought of when I first sort of saw this film and heard the songs, was for the first time in forever, Reprise. When they have to, when they do the, for the first time in forever, oh, I'm such a fool, I can't be free. And when it's overlapping, it makes you feel like you're in a musical. And it actually almost reminds me of, like, one of the songs from Name Is. It was like, and it actually generally feels like you're in a musical when watching it. It's not like, oh, it's a Disney film and they sing songs. It feels like you're in a legit musical.
That's, you know, honestly, that I have to give credit to Robert and Kristen Emerson Lopez. They definitely provided their own voice onto, you know, the Disney songs. Like, you could tell that these are, like, these are the kinds of songs that are Disney-esque, but you could tell that they put in their own flair, just like how, you know, the Sherman Brothers put in their own signature, Howard Ashman and Alan Menken, they put in their own kind of signature, and Robert and Kirsten Anderson Lopez is the same thing.
So, but my spiel on Frozen as a film is the popularity of it is kind of crazy to the point where I thought it was a good, enjoyable movie. You know, it's going to be a classic. We all know this. For me, it might be just a tiny bit overrated in terms of the reception. Yeah. And I'm not saying that as a killjoy. I am not saying that to kill anyone's spirit on the film.
That's fine. That's your opinion. I mean, I'm one of those fans that's like, you know, I understand people don't like it. Because, you know, and some people do say it is overrated. But, you know, I still love it either way.
Yeah, I'll have to admit that was actually something that I wanted to bring up, is in terms of the massive popularity of Frozen. It's just that, like, I do understand, like, when people say it's overrated because, like, it's more the oversaturation of the marketing that literally you cannot walk 5 seconds without seeing something Frozen related. And yeah, I'll admit it is actually pretty crazy on that department. But, you know, like, but my biggest issue is when people are saying that it's overrated, but they're attacking the movie when they say, like, oh my god, it's bad, it's the worst movie ever. Like, when they just want to attack the movie because they see too much of it. That honestly does not make sense. Mm-hmm. And honestly, it makes the Frozen haters, like, less credible. Like, with the way that they're reacting, trust me, believe it or not, it's one of the reviews that people disagree with the most, actually, because of the overpopularity. And a lot of people say that, like, when I say reviews that people disagree with me the most, they would think of, like, when I would be negative but they're positive. It works the other way around, and Frozen is one of the biggest examples. Even though there are a lot of people who love it, there's still that big vocal minority that won't shut up. It's like, hey, it's Frozen is the guy, you're a terrible person for liking Frozen.
I don't hate Frozen.
Idiot from the keyboard?
I don't hate Frozen. I just think I thought it was a good film. I just think the like you said, though, the oversaturation of it being everywhere was kind of weird. They had one of the cast members perform it on Glee during the final season. Once Upon a Time season 4 was based around it, even though actually that was the season that the announcement that said to me, what is this show, Once Upon a Time? And then I got freaking hooked on it. So maybe that was maybe that actually worked. But I also have to say, with the music, what I kind of like to see is other fan bases doing their own takes on the music. And what they have, one of the things that I saw was the Nightmare Before Christmas fans have a parody called Do You Wanna Carve a Pumpkin? it's a duet between Jack and Sally.
Well, that's pretty fun.
And the Bronies have one as well. It's a duet. It's a duet between Pinkie Pie and a one-off character that Weird Al played called Cheese Sandwich. It's called Love is a Yummy S'more. Which I thought was a cute little thing going on there. I think it's gone a little far is when it comes on to Christmas time, we're decorating the house, I turn on Pandora, I say select Christmas music, and Let It Go comes on.
Oh.
And I say, I know it's
not a Christmas film.
It takes place in the middle of the summer. I know it's snowing and everywhere, but that's only because everything is cursed. That does not make it a Christmas movie.
You know, funny enough, there is actually no winter or snow related song other than Frozen Heart, actually.
Yeah, that's it.
Mm-hmm. So, in fact, there's a song that's the complete opposite within summer.
Yeah, because I never finished my thoughts on the film either.
Oh, sorry, Devin, go on.
Well, you see, I love this film too. I don't love it as much as the big Frozen fanatics, but I love it enough where I can appreciate it, and I enjoy it a lot. Like, I will admit, my heart's a lot more into the Alan Menken production. Like the Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast, Hunchback of Notre Dame, Hercules. I love all those movies a lot more. But Frozen has a good place in my heart. I put it in my top, 20 favorites. I really love the character. I was more interested with this film with the characters than the music itself, though I will give them props for making the music as well as they did. The Lopez's did very well, and they leave a good mark. And I'm thrilled they're doing another feature, actually, because maybe they will eventually have as big of a following as, the Sherman Brothers and Alan Menken and his work. As far as Disney's concerned.
Oh, yeah.
But that's the thing. I mean, I appreciate it. It's a great movie my heart's more into the characters and the story than the music itself. The music is great, and I have the soundtrack on my iPod. All the songs are very memorable, so that's, for me, I would put in my top 20. Not the best film out there, but definitely a film worth remembering.
I would have to say, the merchandise is, crazy. I went to Smith's Toy Store and Culture Set ages ago, and they literally had, almost a whole half an aisle dedicated to Frozen. There is so much Frozen and stuff, and yet you can never find the Frozen Simpsons. You can never find them.
Well, that's because they get sold out so quickly.
Yeah, exactly. Sure.
So, I also want to say one last thing.
And I'll say something wrong with your head.
When it goes to Broadway, stick Life's Too Short back in. That is a great song that got deleted.
Oh, I remember that song now. Now I remember.
Life's Too Short. Life's too short.
I'm excited about the Broadway too. I'm very excited about that and the possibility of a sequel. But I want to see too, if for all sakes and purposes, the film is great, and I love it, and I can't wait to see that Broadway musical as well.
Just one more thing. I don't know if anybody saw, but who's excited for the ride at Walt Disney World opening?
I'm curious, actually.
I saw the video on Facebook, and I shared it, and I tagged my sister, and I was like, pack your bags, we're going to Florida!
I'm intrigued, so.
I haven't seen anything just yet, because I'm hoping I would go to Disney World soon, and I want to see, what they have in store.
Can I stow away your suitcase?
Devin, you mentioned your arm earlier. You just reminded me of something. I think it was a year ago they announced a line of Disney themed
Disney arms. Like mechanical arms. Yes,
that's right.
And they had an Iron Man arm and a Hulk arm for the Marvel fans, and for the girls they had a Princess Elsa glove, which I thought was cute because, they gotta have their princess in there. And then I thought, wait a minute, the gloves were on her because they were trying to hide her powers. It might be a little contradictive, but then I thought, you know what, the kids can go around and say, you know why they keep these gloves on? You don't want to see what it comes off.
True.
Yeah, and by the way, Devin, when you mentioned, when you see your arm, like, Elsa's superpowers, are you able to use your stump to go and pierce someone's heart to the point, like, they would almost be dying?
Well, I could give you a hand map, but I know if I gave it to you, you wouldn't give it back to me.
You can ask her ex-boyfriends about it.
He's like, let's shake on it.
You can run it off with my hand and I'd be chasing after you going, what did I get the hell by you? And then Mike would be recording all this, and then James and Morgan would be the ones with the popcorn. Are you kidding me? I already know the scenario.
And then Devin would just ironically beat you with the arm.
You're kidding me.
And then Devin gets the arm back, crunches it into a fist, smacks you with it.
Well, here, hold on. I have to do this one time. Hello. Hi. I'm happy now.
By the way, I thought it was meh. Saw it once, moved on.
Of course, you have just one sentence and that's it.
That's Mike's thoughts on Frozen.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so deep, so profound.
We would never have made it out. You know.
So deep, so profound.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I didn't want to prolong that, but it turned out to be really good, and let's move on to Hairspray.
My movie. Mm-hmm. Now this is my third, for people who know me well, this is my third favorite movie of all time. I adore this movie. Like, when I first saw this, I think I was in high school, I think it was high school. But my mom and I were at the video rental store. And we were looking around trying to see movies, and my mom happened to know that I adored Zac Efron. Huge crush on Zac Efron. Yes. Shut up, Matt. Don't start. But,
We're breaking free!
Oh, you guys. Well, as I'm saying, my mom knew I loved Zac Efron. I had a huge crush on the guy. Well, she saw this movie, and she was like, you should see this, because she knew I liked John Travolta, she knew I liked, and she knew I liked Amanda Bynes and Zac Efron. That's what intrigued me in this movie, was some of the casting. Well, I didn't know anything about this. Then I watched it, and I loved it, to the point where I did all kinds of research, and discovered this movie was based off the Broadway musical based off of the John Waters film of the same name. John Waters made a comedy in 1988, Hairspray.
Which, call it that.
Shush. Shush. Well, John Waters' film is very different from, like, his earlier works. Like, if you know John Waters' name, you wouldn't associate Hairspray with, or any of his works, like, they wouldn't seem like, they wouldn't seem interconnected with his known works. Like, Pink Flamingos, Desperate Living, Female Trouble are more about, well, more adult, almost pornographic stuff. And Hairspray is the more family-friendly movie.
He's related to doo-doo, literally.
It really is. Like, this is the most family-friendly movie he ever created. And the funny thing is, this was based on something that John really loved, and that was the Buddy Dean Show, which was the equivalent of the American Bandstand back in the 60s.
The only thing that was not family friendly about the original film was probably the reefer, but
true. But the Buddy Dean Show was a American Bandstand equivalent where they had teenagers from their local, which was in Buddy Dean's, it was Baltimore. It was took place in Baltimore. All these Baltimore kids or teenagers were all on the show doing dancing and showing the newest dance moves of the 60s. And once a month, they had, well, Negro Day. So that's literally where the actual plot of the film sort of came from. This was his love for that show, sort of in a movie style, and he decided to do something that really was interesting to him, and that was the segregation of the 60s. Mm-hmm. So, and then what made it more interesting is he thought, what is going to be the most interesting aspect? What, instead of a black woman, or instead of a black girl, you could have easily done this movie about a black girl. But no, he decided to do something that nobody would have thought of. The white girl that was overweight. And this was the girl that had to, her name was Tracy Turnblad, and she was a girl that was overweight. She wasn't very popular. She was very independent spirit, but she also wasn't, like, she didn't have that many friends either. In the musical, took that to heart. Like, they took the plot of the movie for very well from the 1988 original. They made some massive changes based on this movie, like in the musical, like, they really changed up some aspects. Like, the original film was mainly about Tracy and her battling, like, her going after her beliefs and trying to integrate the black kids and the white kids onto the dance show, the Corny Collins show, which is pretty much the Buddy Dean equivalent. And it was interesting that they decided to go with this angle. It was really about segregation. Mm-hmm. So I think it's just interesting. Tracy's this girl that goes into stardom. She becomes famous in Baltimore, and then she decides to go after something that she believed in. That was the whole plot of the 1988 film. And then they took this to the musical. They were very interested in making the musical because the producer, Margot Lyon, watched movies while she was sick. She was trying to figure out what's the next musical. What could be the next musical? Hairspray was one of them she picked while she was sick. And she loved it. She thought, this has a right plot of a girl who has the outsider triumphing in what she believes in. She gets the guy, mind you. And the whole movie just manages to use that plot very well. In the musical, they did that. With the only changes they made, though, was that the mother, in the original, was played by Divine. Divine was already confident. It's pretty much a male drag queen, only he was not a drag queen to popular belief. He just liked to dress up as a woman only for John's movies. But he had, like, Edna Turnblad was already confident, already, like, ready to fight for anything. But in the musical, it was backwards. Because in the musical, it was where Edna was afraid to come out of the house because she was so overweight. Well, in the movie, musical and the musical, they kept that plot point in where she was afraid to go outside, but then eventually she comes outside, and that's where the song Welcome to the 60s comes in. And it was funny, because they actually used, like, literally lines from the movie, like, Big, Blonde, and Beautiful, Good Morning, Baltimore, Welcome to the 60s. All lines from the original 1988 film used in the musical. And Mark Shaiman and Scott Whitman wrote the lyrics and songs for that film and the Broadway musical. So what I like about the movie musical is the fact that it was interesting because first of all, my favorite aspect is the casting. I love the fact that there's three things in the Hairspray formula that are very well known. Tracy Turnblad is always played by a newcomer. In the 1988, she was played by Ricky Lake. In the musical, she was played by Marissa Jeanette Winokur. She had only one movie role and it was minor, and that was in American Beauty. And in the movie musical, Nikki Blonsky played her. All newcomers, they had no movie experience or minor movie experience or whatever. In Edna Turnblad, the mother is always played by an actor dressed up as a woman. Divine in the 88 film. Harvey Farnstein, which most people think of Mulan. and then also John Travolta.
Harvey Firestein, also known as Robin Williams' gay brother in Mrs. Doubtfire.
That too. And then, yeah, those are the main three things that they keep. That's part of the Hairspray formula. And they do that. They follow the formula well. And I know that I think they're doing like a Broadway, like a stage show for
NBC.
For NBC, what? And they're going to keep that formula very well, and I'm very excited about it. Thank God.
Yeah.
They're having Harvey Farnstein come back, but I digress. I think the movie Musical works because it's really a movie that I love. It's about something from the 60s. I always had a fascination with the 60s. I always felt like Tracy Turnblad. She was the character that felt felt confident in her beliefs and went after them. And I really love that. And there's other characters like Lynn Turnblad, played by Zac Efron. He's the love interest of the story. And he eventually falls for her because of her inner beauty, not because of her physical appearance. Then there's Penny, played by Amanda Bynes, the best friend who's always been in support of her throughout the whole film. John Travolta plays the mother. Christopher Walken is in this movie. And he's wonderful. I love Christopher Walken, but all that.
The only movie where you'll find Christopher Walken is the husband of John Travolta.
It's a sweet but crazy love story, but I digress.
And he said during interviews how pleasant of a wife John Travolta was.
You know, that's actually true. I do know that. But the music really was all not songs from, like, they actually, when Scott went, Mark Wyman and Scott Whitman were writing these songs, they were using references from 60s bands and anything popular in the 60s pop charts. That's how these songs became so memorable. They figured out what aspects to use from black and white band musicians and bands and whatever, and used it to their advantage, and they wrote these memorable songs ranging from Good Morning Baltimore, I Can Hear the Bells, Welcome to the 60s, You Can't Stop the Beat, Without Love. All these songs are absolutely wonderful, and they're absolutely memorable. I really, out of all the soundtrack, there's only one song that I hate, and it was in the original musical, unfortunately. It was It's Hairspray. It was this one song that came in as...
It's Glenn, because it's Glenn, because it's Hairspray. And then that one?
You? Oh my god, you actually knew that one. Good job, Matt.
Oh, I know.
I remember that.
Don't underestimate me. Don't underestimate me.
My favorite song will always be Without Love. That was always the one number that I always loved. I love the music so much. Like, the music was always the best part to me about that movie, besides the casting of every... Like, the movie to me is just a perfect movie for anybody who has felt like an outsider, like Tracy does. Mm-hmm. And anybody who... Like, in the 60s, and unfortunately, segregation was a big topic. It was kind of a sensitive topic, and I can understand why some people are not as willing to watch it. But I really think it did a very good job of not only following aspects of the original John Waters film, but it really stood on its own, like the musical did. They did their own thing, and they worked well with it. That's why I love it. I mean... that the music was the main thing that really, like, the casting was what got me into it, but it was the music and everything else that got me hooked.
The formula that the film had, I remember watching this first when it came out on video. I was like you, I bought the soundtrack. I've always been into, you know, movies like Grease, that sort of take this time period and build a fun romantic comedy around it, as well as using aspects of the music of the time to further the story, and just sort of have fun with it. And that's what I think Hairspray does. It's maybe not entirely the 60s, you know, we don't go into the hippies and whatnot, but it takes all the parts of the 60s that they can sort of romanticize a little bit and display it in a nice way. I like how they integrate aspects from the original film, which were important to the original. But I remember watching the original film after the musical, and I felt like it was a severe downgrade instead of. You know, sometimes if you look at a remake and say, yeah, the original was better, this to me was the exact opposite. This was one of those rare cases. I felt like with the musical version, that's all it needed was a good solid soundtrack and a mood. An upbeat mood, you know. Even with the trailer for the original Hairspray, the tagline was something like, "Hairspray, it's a step up from Grease," and I was like, so there was that essence where they just wanted to. You feel like maybe with the original they just wanted to go there, but they didn't. They didn't. They should have, and that's what the musical is to me. This is. It is much better in its direction, in its presentation, and its conveyance. It's conveying its message.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna say now that I originally saw this film in the cinema. I think I was about 13, 14 when this first came out, and I have seen it on the West End, and I actually got to see it when there's a quite a famous comedian over here called Phil Jupitus. And when I found out, I found out that he was doing it, playing Edna Dunbar, and I thought, yay, that's cool. And then when I found out I was going to go and see it with my school, and the fact that I got to see Phil Jupitus in it, I was just so excited. And so I've got to see the film, and I saw it on the West End. And I tell you what, stage production, hands down, a lot better than any film version. And the fun fact is that the pantomime I did this year in February, our finale song we did, basically after we'd done all our bows and whatever and we said the last lines, we do like one more song for the audience. And we did You Can't Stop the Beat. And everybody, when we first found out that was going to be it, we were like, oh my God, because then everybody knows that. It's so fast paced. But actually, finally learning that verse and chorus, because the chorus itself is just horrendously fast, but once you put dance moves to it, you finally get to learn it, and you have to try and get it out and get the volume out and enunciate every word. Yeah,
oh my god,
fucking impossible is an understatement.
Mm-hmm. Actually, yeah. I have a funny story. Like I was watching the behind the scenes stuff, and they actually had where they were talking about with the behind the scenes of the movie adaptation. They were talking about every singer that was trying to sing, Amanda Bynes, Zac Efron, Nikki Bonsky. They were struggling to sing this song, and yet Queen Latifah, first take, got it. She didn't even have to breathe or anything. She was so adjusted to it, and the producers and everybody was in shell shock, and they were like, "How the hell did you do that?" And she's like, "I'm a rapper. I'm very good at singing words."
Yeah, she has total, like, she has major experience in all forms of all forms of music, not just rap, but like, this is not even her first musical. She was in Chicago.
Yeah,
oh yes, that is true. And Queen Latifah is gorgeous. I loved Queen Latifah. I got wonderful casting right there. That was
big,
that was,
yeah. Blonde, beautiful.
Yeah, I will have to say, like, I remember seeing Hairspray. It was back in the mid-2000s when me and my family, we were in a high on musicals and stuff like that, including...
Yeah. You were high on musicals?
Yeah, we had a musical night, and it was during the days we were huge fans. Like, we were so big on The Producers, the 2005 musical. So we saw it, and like, overall, Hairspray is just like this one big 60s. I think the best way to describe it is that it is it's like going into a 60s themed party. That's what it is, because like, it's very like, it has a very uplifting, it has a very cheery mood, like it, and everything about it, it nails it, trying to have that 60s tone into it, especially with the songs and the style of music, and even getting like, you often get those chorus girls. That's one thing I'm surprised you didn't mention, Devin, is that often like during the musical numbers, like there were these weird, like, I don't know how to describe it. Like, they don't really connect to the movie itself. They don't have a role. They're kind of like the muses from Hercules.
Oh my, I forgot about that, actually. That is a good point. There's multiple songs that do that, yeah.
They show up on billboards all of a sudden. The new girl in town, new girl in town.
That's right, new girl in town. Welcome to
the Super. And what's actually fun, and what's actually pretty interesting is that it does, like, with all this, like, uplifting 60s mood, it does try to find a way to slip in a kind of like a social message regarding racism, which was actually interesting, because there was one song, like, when you see them walking out protesting, it's like, holy crap, you could definitely feel
that
there was a mood that, like, kind of like the mood is changing. It was like, oh my god, like, things are getting pretty serious, like, holy crap. You take a break from the fun, and then, like, you got this message, like, oh god, that is true.
Oh yeah. Man, this got real all of a sudden.
Yeah, like, it got real. But overall, it's just, it's like, this is the kind of film in general that's just meant to be fun. And by the way, there's one question: whatever happened to that new girl? Movie, but I mean the girl who played the main character. What like the last time I think I heard about her recently was that she, like, her and her dad are in jail somewhere in another country.
Nikki Blonsky.
Yeah, Nikki Blonsky. The last time she was in anything was, I think, 2012 or something like that.
She's listed here as in a movie called Dog Ears, that's supposed to be set coming out this year. But me personally,
I've never heard of. I don't know what's happened to her. The last time I heard her in anything was probably Queen Size 2008, but I didn't pay attention to her movies past that, so I couldn't tell you.
Yeah, the last time I saw her in anything, she played a character on Smash, which is sort of the underrated stepchild of Glee. I highly recommend it.
I'll be right back.
I didn't even recognize her on there. So.
Yeah. I don't know, like, it's just interesting. I don't know what's happened to her, but she was phenomenal in that movie.
Oh, yeah. I think
you can tell
The thing that Matt's referring to, the charges were dropped for that.
Okay. I have no clue what's going on
here. But here's the thing. In 2011, she earned a cosmetology license and began working part-time as a hairstylist and makeup artist in New York between acting auditions.
Pretty cool, to be honest. Yeah, for a long time, she was actually working at Cold Stone before she got the role.
Yeah, no. Like, what's actually pretty famous is that there's famous clips going around, or, like, behind-the-scenes video. In fact, I remember the Academy recently, they posted a video highlighting casting directors, and they were talking about trying to find her. And what they did was they did a special thing where they legit filmed her at her cold store, and
Cold,
like,
Stone.
They filmed Cold Stone, and, like, I think she was pretty much having a Skype chat with either John Waters, or she was talking with someone saying that she got the part.
Yeah, that's...
So, yeah, like, she was at Cold Stone Steve Austin. Yeah.
Yeah, that I do know. You know the one funny thing about the movie? Most people don't realize this. John Waters actually played a cameo. He actually had it. Like, do you know in the early part of Good Morning Baltimore, where she's walking down the street, and all of a sudden she's singing about, I think she was singing about strippers or whatever. He's the guy that lifts out his coat and the two women scream. That's John Waters.
Of course. Of freaking course. That's John Waters' part.
That was the best thing about that. It cracked me up so much. I was like, oh my
course.
God.
I am
Good
nuts.
Morning, Baltimore. There's a flasher who lives next door. There's the drunk on the barroom stool. They wish me luck on my way to school.
Oh my god, that was the best. That made my day when I saw that. I was like, good job, John.
So I actually do have a funny news story. I don't know if I could pull this up now, but I remember reading this back then. There was actually one controversy that this film drummed up during its production, and I find it so kind of amazing, actually. I may have mentioned this before. You may know what I'm talking about.
I think I have.
You mentioned that one of the trends with the film was that Edna Turnblad is always played by a man.
Yeah.
But what do Divine with Divine and Harvey Fierstein, or Firestein, however they pronounce it, it's a case of...
Yep, Mike has got it up.
Washington Blade boycott controversy.
This is all about John Travolta. This was all about his.
It's on Wikipedia. It's on Wikipedia if you want to read up on it.
Okay, but yes,
yeah, it's on the Wikipedia page.
Because
go on, James.
Because John Travolta is a Scientologist. One of the things that they came up with was, well, in Scientology you have. They have anti-gay training classes, and so it's not thought of as being a gay-friendly religion. But the only thing that I see when I look at this, and by the way, John Travolta's in the closet, pretty much, or. To a degree, you know, Carrie Fisher mentioned him in an interview one time. They said, "Oh yeah, we all knew he was gay. We just didn't say anything about it." The thing that I find silly about this controversy is that it's when you watch. When you watch anyone else portraying the role of Edna, you're so into the story, you're not concerned with the gender of the person playing her. And that's what makes the story work. So I look at the casting of Travolta as not the casting of a casting of someone based on their sexual persuasion, but I think it was just to get the greasers in.
Kind of like a grease homage in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's probably what it was. If that's the original intent of why John Travolta was picked. It wasn't because of his religion or anything. It's because they were playing homage to the original film and the musical. They wanted to bring an homage, and that's how they do it. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. I thought John Travolta was wonderful. And I saw nothing wrong with doing all that homage at all. I mean, a film that's willing to bring, like, a film, even the musical, that's what actually Margot Lyon's intent was when she made the musical. She wanted to homage things from the original film, and they did that very well. In the movie musical, Adam Shankman, the director, he clearly loved the original musical, and he loved the film too, so he wanted to homage it just as much as anyone else did. They put their heart into it, and that makes it a great adaptation. I actually have to agree with James on the 1988 film. I thought it was not a downgrade, but I didn't find it as good as the 2007 version. I haven't seen the musical, but I've heard the soundtrack, I've heard the cast recording, and I think it's good. Like, I really like some of the people that were in it, but I find myself a lot more drawn to the 2007 film. And even though there is a lot of things that they do differently, like, for example, Tracy doesn't go to jail. Unfortunately, that was in the original Broadway musical, and that was in the original John Waters film. They got rid of that for time purposes, fair enough. But I really don't mind some of these changes, because it's a film first. So you're trying to condense a really long film to 2-hour length, and they still manage to keep the tone and spirit of the original. So that's why I like it. It will love it, obviously. So.
That, and how else are you going to have Zac Efron do a duet with somebody's portrait?
Well, Zac Efron is amazing. He actually did some homages to Elvis during this Lady Choice song, which is pretty funny as hell. I was like, yes.
That was an amazing effect during Without Love, when they're singing together and like the portrait is singing at the same time.
Okay, that was awesome. I will not deny that year. I was like, oh my god, I was geeking out like a little schoolgirl, but that's natural for a romance girl like me, but still. Mm-hmm. So that's my screaming on the phone.
Good. Let's, I haven't seen any of it, so let's go on to something a little different from the previous two. Let's go a little different and talk about Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Oh, boy. Yeah. There's a story that I would like to attach to this one about a man by the name of Robert Stigwood. If you don't know him right off the bat, you may know some of the movies that he's produced. One of them is called Grease, and the other one is actually a movie that we have to get to talk about later. But I won't spoil it. And so the story goes like this. Robert Stigwood is he's got his hands on a bunch of Beatles music, and he's got permission to make a musical out of it. The idea is take the most successful album of the time, and this, let's see, the year. Yeah, this movie is the 1978. So up until that time, the Beatles' 1967 album, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, was the most highest selling album. So, it started off as a concept that Stigwood produced for an off-Broadway production in 1974. And several years later, they decided to turn it into a musical, 1978. But wait a minute. How are you going to make a Beatles movie without the Beatles? Well, Stigwood had an ace in the hole. He was not just a movie producer, he was also the band manager for the hottest band at the time, the Bee Gees.
Oh, dear.
So, yes, that's who's headlining this movie. Peter Frampton, the Bee Gees, and a number of other familiar faces, both musical and comical, and actor and whatnot. What could possibly go wrong?
Everything? Lying in the cupboard?
Well, except for the lion in the cupboard.
Flan? Yeah, it's like, apparently it's like, if you leave a flan in the cupboard, it deflates. Am I?
Oh, okay. I didn't know that. That's good advice.
I don't know, it was a line of Eddie Izzard's, so it was like, well, there clearly must be, like, some analogy.
Okay. The good thing I can say about this is, okay, I'll just brush through the plot of the film here. The titular Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band is a band that's born right out of a small town called Heartland, USA. Sergeant Pepper's, according to the film's history, was a sergeant who played for the troops back during the First and the Second World Wars, but he passed away in the 50s. So in the 70s, the band is reborn. It's got all new members and everything that look a lot more like the Bee Gees and Peter Frampton. And this new band is popular enough in their hometown that they create a demo record that gets sold off to Donald Pleasance over in L.A., who takes them in and decides to represent them as a band. What they don't know is that there's a fiendish plot afoot that while they're gone, comedian Frankie Howard posed as Mean Mr. Mustard, which is a Beatles song that everyone's forgotten, is buying up all the property in Heartland, trying to sell it, and that it's an evil plot with the music industry. So we have our first conceptual problem with this. This is a film that's basically made by the music industry, portraying the music industry as evil. Why? I don't know. Second issue. The film has all these Beatles songs. They don't just pull songs from Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. They also pull it from songs from Abbey Road and whatever else they can pick, and that's where we get so many different character names, like Dr. Maxwell, played by Steve Martin. Mean Mr. Mustard as well. Mr. Kite, who's the mayor of Heartland, played by George Burns, who's really the only thing pushing this story forward. He's not just the mayor of the town, he's also the narrator who fills in everything, because there's no dialogue in the film whatsoever in between anybody. It's all just singing the songs and hoping that's enough to push the movie forward. It's not.
Well, clearly the movie is only interested in trying to sing all those Beatles songs. I had to do something. I mean, it's not... How long is it? 80? 90 minutes? It's not long for nothing.
It's close to 2 hours. Too long.
I'm a freaking old man. You know, I need my time. I need to spend it wisely.
Let's see, who else do they have? Characters like... We got character names like Lucy Diamond, Yes. Get it? Lucy Diamond? It's such an in-your-face reference!
Does she live in the sky?
She wishes.
Alright, guys. It's screeching time in Homeland.
We have, and oh yes, Peter Frampton's character, Billy Shears, he's the only, if you listen to the lyrics to the song Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, one of the lines is, "May I introduce to you the one and only Billy Shears?"
Mm.
So, he's the lead singer of the band. Okay, Billy Shears. That works. That works. His girlfriend's name is Strawberry Fields.
Okay, that's just stupid.
That's pushing it. That is really pushing it.
Who the fridge names their kid Strawberry?
The issue with the film is that after the opening number, which is Sgt. Pepper, blah blah blah, almost every song that they use has no purpose of moving the plot forward, and that is an issue with that is the issue, it seems like, with any jukebox musical featuring Beatles music. I think after this and Across the Universe, there ought to be a law against using Beatles music in a jukebox musical, because nobody can apparently do it right.
Lies. That's a lie, and I have proof.
Because that actually included that actually had participation of the Beatles.
True. Okay, I'll give you that.
I think that's overrated too, but that's just my deal. I will be willing to give that a second chance, Matt, one of these days.
What is it that made Yellow Submarine work in contrast to Sgt. Pepper?
It had a story. It had
I guess that's
actual dialogue. Whatever Sgt. Pepper's is doing, if you have to have the plot explained to you by a narrator and not told to you because the characters can't tell it to you because they're always singing, that's a problem. Beatles music just does not work as an opera. As a rock opera, it doesn't. And what was the plan? The music industry is trying to take over the world using magical Sgt. Pepper's instruments. It was something like that. They don't clearly explain everything.
So it doesn't make sense in the bad way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and to think, They got so much musical talent behind this. Alice Cooper is in the movie. Aerosmith is in the movie. The whole finale of the film is just one big cameo festival, featuring every guest that they could possibly muster up to this for this thing. Tina Turner. The band Heart, Yvonne Elliman. If you know of an artist that was popular in the 70s, chances are they sang in the chorus at the end of the film.
Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Huh?
Fire were also in it.
Yes, Earth, Wind, and Fire. So sounds what?
Sounds like it's a musical version of Roger Rabbit.
Yeah.
Only without the great cameos.
Yeah, only without cameos that work. Roger Rabbit had a story, and interesting characters, and a hero to root for. This movie has Jack all. This is how they. We were talking about this before. And this is how they incorporate the music in the film after the opening number. When they're going to L.A., they take off in a hot air balloon like the Wizard of Oz. An airplane flies by, crashes into the balloon, and suddenly the band's on the airplane looking around like, what just happened? They land in L.A., and Donald Pleasance comes up to them and starts speak singing, I want you. I want you so bad. It's driving me mad. Devin, you saw this. Tell me you saw that.
I was too busy laughing my ass off. I was like, I want you so bad. I want you so bad. I'm like, honey, if you want to go screw him, just go find another place to do it. I swear, that's exactly what my mindset was at the time. I'm like, do you want to screw him or do you not want to screw him? What's wrong with you?
Your mom was watching this with you?
Nope.
Okay.
No, okay, I'm not good. I'm not subjecting my mother to this torture. I'm sorry. I was not willing to do that. I did not like this movie at all. Fuck this movie, I'm done.
What was your term for it again? Background noise?
Yep. It was beautiful background noise, all I heard. Like, literally at first, I was sort of getting into it with how stupid and lame it was. But then, like, halfway in, I just went, what the hell's going on? And I gave up.
I mean, the climax, or I shouldn't say the climax, but close to the end in the third act, there's a subplot in which Mean Mr. Mustard kidnaps Strawberry Fields. And of all the song choices that they have to come up with, they sing When I'm 64 as a duet.
Why? That's not even an evil song.
It
makes more sense when they did it in Yellow Submarine when all the Beatles are suddenly old.
He's singing it to her like he's gonna kidnap her and marry her off or something, like, will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64? And she's singing along for some reason and she's crying. Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64?
Might as well do that with you might as well do the same thing with frickin' I Need Mine.
Oh my god.
That, in fact, that actually would make a better villain song than that. All through the day, I'm me mine, I'm me mine, I'm me mine. Oh my Even god, my those god. Tears, I'm me mine, I'm me mine, I'm me mine.
No, if they want a villain song, turn him into a rapist singing, Why Don't We Do It in the Road?
I found a better comparison with what you just said. You know, like, in like, if they're gonna do it with When I'm 64, they might as well also do, like, they might as well make a villain song out of I Wanna Hold Your Hand.
I can see that maybe working a little bit better if it was only him singing it.
Really? I feel happy inside. It's such a feeling that my love, I can't hide, I can't hide, I can't hide.
Oh my, James, you know how you were saying about odd song choices? You know the scene where they did Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds and how weird as fuck the presented? All I remember from that was the fact that there was a bunch of black women all dressed up in these, like, really weird, like, sparkly dresses. And they were, like, singing, I think they were either singing in the sky or singing, like, all over. I don't remember very good. All I remember was looking up going, they're singing Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. What the fuck? Do you remember that?
Yeah, they were on a stage. The whole scene was this was a moment in which Sgt. Pepper's was a band on the rise in Hollywood. To become an overnight sensation, because that's how the music industry works, right? No, it doesn't. But yeah, remember the scene that you're talking about. It got trippy.
All I remember was, what the fuck is it? My brain's hurting. That's all I remember. I don't remember anything about the scene other than the fact that we're singing the song. I was like, oh my god.
Yeah, this is... It's an excellent exercise in how not to make a movie, but the only reason that I sat all the way through to the end is because I happen to like the Beatles and I happen to like the Bee Gees. So the only way that
you get the Bee Gees?
Bee Gees?
Hey.
I would listen to that actually. What you could totally do is do band mashup styles, like, you know, take Beatles music and do it more disco.
I actually heard that. I remember years ago I was at a club and there was a song that came out that it was like a Beatles song, and then suddenly it was mixed with EDM. Like it's like the Beatles versus something. It was actually a pretty cool song. And yeah, I could tell Beatles won.
Yeah, it's... I would only recommend this film. I'm not going to recommend it to anybody. Only if you're a hardcore enough Beatles and Bee Gees fan. To the film's credit, the one thing that the one thing that does continuously work throughout is at least the Bee Gees sound good. They always did. But does this make it a good film? No. But I can chalk that off my bucket list because I've seen it. I also have a theory as to why probably they didn't have any dialogue in the movie, because if they did, this is a movie that takes place in the USA, so everyone's supposed to be, you know, from the USA. Well, the Bee Gees are a British band, so if they had them talking and not putting on an American accent, that would have been trouble right there. At least I think.
Especially the fact that, you know, the Beatles come from Liverpool. So that would have been a bit weird.
Why does this movie take place in America?
Because America. Hey, why is the film set in the US? America.
But it could be set anywhere else. But America.
What do these pancakes taste like? America.
What's 2 plus 2? America.
America.
Very true.
Yep, Britain the Canadian making fun of America. Just how it should be.
Well, hey, we're busy too much lately making fun of ourselves, so...
Yeah, that's true.
Somebody else has to chip in. Alright.
I already said mash for me.
Well, the thing is, I've never seen Sgt. Pepper's, and in a way, I think I'm just going to stick with the album. To be honest.
Yeah.
By the sound of it, I think I'm better off with the album.
She's so heavy!
I knew it!
Do you remember that scene in the film, Devin? When they're singing Heavy?
Sort of? Okay, maybe there is something else I can add. Sort of. I don't know the Beatles like a lot of people do. I was always more of a... Shush. I was always more of an Elvis fan. Shut up.
Sad. She liked Elvis for his affinity with Nixon.
Well, yeah. Oh my god.
It is not illegal when the president does it.
Oh! That reminds me. There's a movie I need to try to get for a screening. We definitely have to watch that movie.
Nixon.
Yes. Oh. Yes. Came out this year. Oh, I totally forgot about that until now. I haven't seen Sgt. Pepper, by the way. I have not seen it. I don't have any interest in Sgt. Pepper because, I mean, I'm not a hugest fan of the Beatles. I mean, I know most of their music. I think I like Paul McCartney the most as a solo artist and when he did with the Wings stuff, but...
I had my phase. I
was never into the Beatles either. I wasn't a huge Beatles person. I was always more Elvis. Trust me, as a kid, I believed that when I was a little kid, mind you, I believed that almost the Beatles were like the devil because I knew too much about Elvis and how he got overshadowed. That was my mindset at the age of like 7. So
I wasn't willing. Even though Elvis inspired the Beatles.
I meant, you know, like how the Beatles overshadowed or took over the Beatles mania. That's what I was referencing in the 60s. That's what I was talking about, but that was my mindset as a little kid. I didn't want to
get
listen
overshadowed
to
by peanut butter and banana sandwiches.
You know, shut up.
Devin, my dear, you are forgiven. I mean, the fact that... Yeah, I had my phase when I was 15. And I've been to the Beatles Museum in Liverpool. And I've been to it twice. I've been to Liverpool and I've been to the Beatles Museum.
Yeah, because... Like, yeah, that's when I was, like, 7, though. As I got older, I started to sort of appreciate them more. I mean, I do like their music, but not enough to call myself a hardcore fan or anything. So... Were people like Jacob Matt being a hardcore Beatles fan good for you? I'm just more of a hardcore fan. That's just how I roll. Like, I would watch any of his movies the day of the week before I rewatch Sgt. Pepper or Across the Universe, which I have seen, by the way, that sucked.
I have a fun fact. When I was 14, I was in a school band, and the drama class had a production and they called it Sergeant Pepper's Take Two. And what it was just basically the drama group acting out and dancing out the songs from Sergeant Pepper's. And my band, we actually got to perform with a little help from my friends. And originally who was supposed to sing the lead was this guy who was like rhythm guitar, but he didn't in the end. So I ended up singing it. And what happened was is that in the first performance we did, my microphone got stuck because we had these panels that hid us, the band, whilst the first number went on. And then as you get to Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, we got revealed. My teacher who was in the band was trying to make sure to count everybody in, didn't realise that the panel was supposed to go from right to left, but instead it went left to right and my microphone got stuck. So at one point I'm trying to get it out and it's really stuck. They move the pallet, it falls over, so I have to stop playing the bass and I have to try and run it on the floor, get it in, and I missed a chunk out of the song. And I got the piss taken out of me afterwards. I was like, what can I do? I was trying to ram that microphone stand so it would just stay still, but I kept going, you know.
Yeah, got to. That's the show must go on.
Luckily, it was that performance we did, that was to the school, and then the next two performances we did was to the parents, so phew. But yeah, but we had the proper jackets, you know. I got to be the blue one. I got to be Paul McCartney. So yeah, because I was a little bit, because I was the bass player.
Okay, so If I have a recommendation at the end of all this, Hard Day's Night. That's my recommendation for a Beatles movie. It's funny. It's in the moment. It works.
Or if you want, like, actually, like, even though it's just, I think, like, 5 or 3 minutes long, check the mic. Could you stop? Stop breathing in the freaking mic! I swear to God.
I'll blow the mic.
Anyways, not like, definitely check out the opening to Beatles Rock Band. That is awesome.
Oh, that is.
Actually, the game is what really got me into the Beatles.
I never played that.
Oh, well, it depends.
Well, I mean, it is pretty expensive, especially, and it takes up a lot of space. Like, have you played Rock Band before, James?
I've played Guitar Hero and Drum Hero, and I've played games like Rock Band.
Yeah, keep in mind, like, do you enjoy those games, or...
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then I recommend you should try it out, then.
Yeah. I remember getting the starter kit, which came with a microphone, a Paul McCartney bass guitar, and the drums. And most of the time I used to play the drums, you know. Because the guitar bit's really hard, but drums seem...
Actually, interestingly enough, James, you actually, like, in the game, you go through their career. Like, you start out in the underground and all the way up to the roof of Apple Studios, I believe.
Oh, yeah.
I'll probably stay in the early years. I like them when they were doing the 60s stuff, mostly.
Actually, most of it is the early stuff. Because they cover a lot of parts. It's not just the underground. But there's also, like, one of the major performances, I think, like, one of the Super Bowls, and also they did Ed Sullivan. Like, those are some of the stages that you're in. All right. They also go into some of the psychedelic stuff, like, there's actually one part that they're in Yellow Submarine. What else?
Hey, look, we're cartoon characters.
Well, they're mostly dressed...
Or even the smoking.
Watch out, it's the statue of Queen Victoria. Oh, no.
You could pass for the originals, probably all the originals.
Let's talk about, finally, Les Mis. Les Miserables.
Les Miserables.
Yeah. A wonderful performance in Les Miserables.
To quote my parents, can it get any more miserable? Yes, I am talking about a film, like, I did this for my audition for Casino Royale. And the reason I thought I'd go for this film, because actually this was a monumental film for me, and I'll explain a little bit later. So basically, Les Miserables, or The Miserable, the musical film came out in 2012 for the US, and then it came out in 2013 for the UK, because how should you do? And basically, the whole point of Les Miserables, it is actually based on the book by Victor Hugo, who also did The Hunchback of Notre Dame. And the whole basis of Les Mis is that you follow these characters. And I think it starts off in the year 1835, and it's a couple of years after the French Revolution, and once again, there's a king on the throne. And you first meet a character called Jean Valjean, who is played by Hugh Jackman. And, of course, you meet Javert, who is played by Russell Crowe. So, basically... Sorry.
And I'm Javert!
Exactly. So, anyway, and then you follow his story, and you very much follow Jean Valjean throughout the whole film. And, of course, you come across characters like Fantine, who's played by Anne Hathaway. And, of course, unfortunately, he dies, like a lot of people in this film. And also you follow Cosette, who's played by Amanda Seyfried, who's the daughter of Fantine. The the innkeeper and the wife, the daughter of the innkeeper and the wife you follow as well. You follow Javert as well, for some reason. And basically, this film, there are some memorable songs in there. Some of them get sort of cut down because, you know, timings and whatever, and of course it's a film, so naturally things get chopped down, and of course things get altered because it's a film. But the one thing that made this film monumental for me is it's not the first film I saw in the cinema. That had been done years before. This was actually the first film I cried at. And I remember being in the cinema with my then boyfriend, and it was a case where I was told, everyone tells everyone that, you know, you always cry at the end. The ending's really sad, so naturally you're going to cry and stuff. And literally by the end of the film, I'm blowing my eyes out. Literally, I'm just like having a proper sob. I mean, unfortunately, James and Mike didn't get to see the result of that because I watched that ending scene a couple of days before the screening. So, but I did my fair share of crying, so don't you worry. But basically, you know, this film I wouldn't exactly recommend for anyone who wants pink and fluffy stuff, you know, because this is Les Miserables. It is The Miserable. But the things in this film that I really like in this is basically two performances, or actually three performances in a way. You've got Anne Hathaway's Fontaine. And the one thing I remember when I did performing arts at college is that when I was in my singing class, I was taught one thing. When you're doing a singing performance, if you lack one part, you back it up with the other. So say, for instance, you lack the vocal quality, no problem, back it up with performance quality, and vice versa. So if you lack the performance quality, just back it up with vocal quality. Anne Hathaway, she not only manages to balance out the white bands, as to say, but she does it beautifully. She is able to hit those notes. She can add performance and emotion in there that you really make, you know, because it's not like, so that when you're watching it, it's not like, oh, it's Anne Hathaway singing I Dreamed a Dream. You actually feel like this is Fontaine or what's happened to her. And I remember when I did the screening with Mike and James, one thing that Anne Hathaway does really well at the end of the song, you know, because by the time she's getting to the end of the song, she's hyperventilating from tears because of the emotion. But there's one thing she does when she does the I Dream, that bit, there's something in the eyes and face that makes you think, I don't care anymore. Because basically, like, beforehand, like, yes, I Dreamed the Dream is put in the wrong place of the film, you know, but in the film it's put after Pretty Ladies, and the fact that she's just going around trying to raise funds for her daughter and trying to do all she can. But at the end of I Dreamed the Dream, it's a case where you see in her face, it's like, there's no point anymore. You know, I'm just doing it now for the money. And yes, I've got to do it for my daughter, but I had this dream and it's gone. So what have I got now? Apart from my daughter, who I don't get to see, there's not much. So she gives up on life. But then when Jean Valjean says, I'll take you to a doctor, you see the hope go back into her, and the fact that, you know, I will bring your daughter. And of course, Fontaine dies. Many people doing this film. And I have to admit, I do tear up at I Dreamed a Dream, because who wouldn't? I mean, Anne Hathaway does it brilliantly. And of course, I teared up slightly with Come With Me when she's talking about Fontaine. And then basically, I usually cry at the end when Jean Valjean starts to die. But yeah, didn't the other day. But also, the other performance I want to talk about is Amanda Seyfried, who many people would know from her... basically, people would know from her performance in Mamma Mia, which is another musical.
Which is a great example of a musical, because unlike Sgt. Pepper's, it actually knows where to use songs.
Yeah, but actually, I'm going to make a bold statement that I made to James and Mike ages ago. Out of the two performances she's done in Les Mis and Mamma Mia, I prefer her performance in Les Mis, because she has got such an angelic voice. And the fact that in Les Mis, she can really hit those high notes. Like, the ones that are, like, really ear-piercingly high. She can hit them. She can really well hit them. And basically, in this is more operatic and more classical. So I think this suited her voice a lot better. And I forgot to mention about Anne Hathaway is that I said to James Mike, if Anne Hathaway ever decides to go to, like, to do stuff on Broadway, musicals and stuff, or come to the West End, yeah, she's got it, because I think in a way that's what makes her underrated, because she's got such a good voice, and I think that could certainly add a string to her bow, even if she doesn't make it into musicals. An album, maybe? You know, like I said, you know, it will add a string to her bow. And the other performance I wanted to talk about was Hugh Jackman. And basically, he's the one that has to carry this, because Jean Valjean is quite an important character, because you literally follow through his story. And Hugh Jackman, he totally knew how to do it. Like, he gives this really good performance, he can sing the songs, and he can add emotion at times, you know, and it's quite emotional when, you know, he starts to die. And I think with Hugh Jackman, he gives that performance so that you are rooting for Jean Valjean. Because most people probably wouldn't root for him because, you know, he's a crook. But actually, you would. Because of his story. And so basically...
It's a story about redemption.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, the fact is, with these three actors, if they ever decide to... I mean, Hugh Jackman, I think, has already done stuff on Broadway. I think he played Gaston in... Beauty and the Beast. Amanda Siegfried? Siegfried?
Siegfried?
Siegfried? Thank you. Amanda. If Amanda decides to go... if she decides to go and do stuff on Broadway, I think, yeah, definitely. Or maybe a studio album. Yeah, go for it. And halfway, no question about that. Mm-hmm. And then there's the performances and bits that were nitpicky for me. One... thing I have to say about Javert. Hi, Russell Crowe. I mean, yes, I think he did a lot better performance than Piers Morgan and Mamma Mia, but in a way, his voice is so pop-like, because everybody else has had proper training. They've had proper Broadway training.
Can I say something here? I think the best way to describe Russell Crowe is what Sacha Baron Cohen said during the Golden Globes when he was just, like, totally drunk. He stated, like, the company spent $4,000 on Russell Crowe to have music, to have vocal lessons. That was money well spent. And now here are the nominees for Best Animated Feature. That's legit what he said.
Yeah, exactly. Because basically everybody else sounds like they recorded it on set, and basically it sounds classical, it sounds operatic. Russell Crowe sounds too pop-like, like pop star like, and it sounds like it was recorded in a studio. And in a way, it's just like, why? And also, it's like there's no emotion or performance in the voice. He's just singing it. And his face is, like, I think he just literally has one facial expression throughout the whole thing, which is just concerned or hunting for Jean Valjean face, you know. It's literally that sort of thing. So, yeah, so thank God he died about, you know, a good portion through, you know. It's a shame we had to hear the bones crunching. And then...
What else do you expect from a guy whose band is called 30-Odd Foot of Grunts?
Russell Crowe has a band?
Yeah. Russell Crowe has a band where he sings the lead.
Yeah, yeah. I thought I told you guys that during the screening of Les Mis. I told you that he's a musician, a rock musician. Actually, and he has his own band.
You know, funny enough...
Excuse me, what I bomb?
You know, the funny thing is that this isn't the only musical that he has done. On stage, I think I recall, Russell Crowe, he played Dr. Scott in a Rocky Horror Show.
Yes, you're right, Matt. Yes, I remember that. Yes,
I knew he was in with a bad crowd.
Yes, yeah, I remember reading that. I was like, yep, he was in Rocky Horror when it was in Australia. Yep. Yep.
So basically,
could be worse. He could be as Frankenfurther. Don't dream it, be it.
Not as a sweet transvestite
from transsexual Transylvania.
Right. And then the other performances I want to talk about were, I mean, they were good, but in a way I was thinking about it today at work. Sacha Baron Cohen's performance as the innkeeper, when he's singing the song, I don't know if it's because the song was in a different key and sometimes the tempo goes all over the place. Like, he's trying to play it too much as a smarmy sort of French person, when really in the original music, the guy, he's, you know, he's a cheeky chappy, you know, he's doing all this weird stuff, but he's doing it because he's JK. He's like, ah, you know, that sort of stuff. But like, Sacha Baron Cohen was trying to play it suave, when really the character isn't supposed to be suave. He's supposed to be, you know, this con artist person and a cheeky chappy as well. Helen Bonham Carter, I mean, she was good in it, but in a way, it's just like, it's kind of resembling, like, her costume and everything and her performance kind of resembles, like, her performance from Sweeney Todd. In a way, it was nothing so great. And I mean, she screwed up a line in Master of the House, which you can do really well, which is, think he's quite a lover, but there's not much there. And some performances where I've seen where they go, like, think he's quite a lover, but the... But she just sort of said it, and it was just like, you know, she's
yeah, quite... I get what you mean. It takes away the joke. No, she doesn't even do it. It's like, I remember in that scene in particular, she's just like trying to swoon a guy or something.
Yeah, sitting on a guy's lap, just singing. It's like, God's sake.
They're trying to do like some kind of striptease or something.
Yeah, and also, like, I feel like they chopped out a good verse because it talks about, like, something else. And they go straight into the next bit of the chorus where they talk about, like, water on the line, da 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 da, and all that stuff. And it's like, you're rushing a good song. It's, you know, you have to do all of it, do it in the original tempo and stuff, and you get into a song where you can have a good knees up, you have a good sing song. And it's like, Sacha Baron Cohen, Helen Bonham Carter, they were just doing it. Oh, we're going to perform it like this because it's our characters. Oh, we're singing the song because we are. It's like, come on, it's a good knees up song. And I have to talk about the scene where that usually makes me cry. And before I did the screening, I did watch this scene and have a good blub. And that is when Jean Valjean dies and the usual trigger line. And that is when Cosette goes, you'll live, Papa, you're going to live. Boom, waterworks. And it's just like really sad. And I actually really like that scene because it's a death scene that was actually, I think, done with dignity, because most times when you see a death scene in a film, it's like, you're not gonna die in here, and all this sort of stuff. But they did it really gently. Jean Valjean knew he was gonna die, and it's like, don't worry, everything's gonna be fine. Please read this when I die. And you see Anne Hathaway come back as Fontaine, and it's done so gently and soft. And you see the emotion that the characters have. And naturally, you're gonna have a tear or two at the end. I mean, it's like Jean Valjean dying. If there's gonna be any death in this film you're going to cry at, it's most likely going to be Jean Valjean's. Because, you know.
Not with Russell Crowe. Not with that flat
note. God, with the bone crunching.
The death note of, there is nowhere to go.
Oh! Crunch.
Oh. Ow. Okay, can I have my say on Les Mis?
Yeah,
sure.
Because, oh boy, what a wacky film. Now, admittedly, this was one of the recent films. It did make me shed a tear at the end, mostly because of the pacing of the movie and the whole scenario. But that's pretty much it. Other than that, it is a goofy film altogether, especially with all the casting. And I might be a little bit, like, some people would consider me, like, I could be a little more harsh to it, but there are some elements, it's either stupid or they just make fun of it. Honestly, I am not a fan of Anne Hathaway in this film, like, because a lot of people say, like, oh my gosh, she's a queen, she is glorious in, like, when she was singing I Dream a Dream. I don't know, it feels like she's trying, she's trying a little too hard. But like, because like when you look at the original Broadway show, she would, like, you know, they would sing, like, she would sing it with grace, you know? The girl who would sing it, like, it's very elegant, and you can feel the sadness. And here, she pushes it way too much to be sad. It's like,
imagine it could be like that if everything's on tits.
That's like putting on a giant freaking puppy. Like, for the longest time, it's just 5 minutes of Anne Hathaway putting on a freaking puppy face. And, but then at the same time, you also got, like, another mixed
up. How dare you? That scene made me cry in the theaters.
Did it make you go,
he's going for it tonight, isn't he?
But then another part is, another messed up casting is Helena Bonham Carter and Sacha Baron Cohen. That combination reminds me way too much of frickin' Sweeney Todd. Like, even when they're singing Master of the House, like, in my mind, all I can think of is just, drop your enemies, miracle and elixir, get a little trick, sad train, sad train. But one of the performances that I was honestly really surprised about is that this is the movie that introduced me to Eddie Redmayne. And my God, I remember back in the day when this movie was released, everybody would make fun of him because he sounded like a freaking Muppet. Because, like, he always sounds like he had a frog in his throat, and then suddenly came the theory of everything, and now he's, like, this ultimate beloved actor. It's like this weird immediate transition. Like, how do we go from making fun of the guy to suddenly becoming a glamorous actor? And I won't deny, he's definitely great. Not in Les Mis, though. Not much of a singer, unless he wants to join a Jim Henson production.
I thought you were going to say I have to admit, he's incredibly hot. I don't know why you're going to say that, but yeah, I mean, he is good in this film.
Yeah, so is his puppeteer. My name is Marius Ponmasier.
Fuck you. Yeah. Anyway, I don't know if I should mention this, but basically, shut up.
You can punch man any time.
Empty chairs and empty tables.
I was about to say about a really heartfelt moment. There's much blabbering on.
Why are you picking apart the moments where everyone's gonna get choked up and make fun of that, and just say that was that was terrible. That
also,
was
because I'm evil.
He's a dickhead. I just want to mention one more performance.
Alright.
One more performance. And this is Samantha Banks as Eponine, and she.
Eponine.
Yeah. I actually liked Eponine. That was a performance I liked.
Yeah.
And basically, she does the performance really well. And I think she was in a production of Les Mis when they asked her to do it. Samantha Barks. Okay.
I remember when I was watching Les Mis, I actually find Samantha Barks more attractive than Amanda Seyfried. It's like,
yeah.
And I was just,
yeah,
like,
me too, me too.
I was just thinking, it's like, Marius, why the frick are you going with her, man?
Exactly. And I cried when she died.
Exactly.
No. Okay.
Yeah, I went to the bathroom to use the toilet. I come back. There's Mikey crying his eyes out. I'm like, Mikey.
Yeah, that was one part I actually liked, and she was really good at it.
She was. But,
okay, let me get back into my evil bastard mode, because there was another performance I did not like. Frickin' Gavroche. That stupid little kid. I don't know about you guys, I always got the sensation that little kid there is like frickin' Scrappy-Doo. That kid's freaking Scrappy-Doo. Like, don't you, like, imagine this. Don't you see that scenario? It's like, let me out. I'll fight him off with puppy power.
Exactly. Puppy power.
Actually,
exactly.
Actually, I see him more like the Artful Dodger from Oliver.
Bye, man.
But either way, I just feel like he's just some dumb, annoying kid. I don't know. I didn't like him.
You didn't like him. Okay.
It's sad when he dies.
What else is there?
Anyone else want to riff?
Hugh Jackman, I mean, I won't deny, definitely great, but, like, I have to admit, the vibrato on the dude is a bit much.
You can never have too much vibrato.
What's that? Know, like the vibrato.
Yeah,
know,
that
vibrato is when the
like
the voice sort of trembles.
Must
2, 4, 6, 0, 1
Oh, that okay.
But I don't know. There are times when he sounds like his vibrato is not fast enough. Like it just sounds like a freaking siren.
That sounds perfectly fine to me.
I don't know. It just kind of turns off. But then my favorite part. Oh, how it brings me joy. The beauty of Russell Crowe as Javert. I don't know what the fridge were they thinking, but they decided to bring him on. Oh, but it's just, it's glorious. Everything.
Why does everyone hate this performance so much? It wasn't that bad.
No, it
it's crap. It's kind of like a trend. Well, I don't know. It's just laughable in a way. Because like I compared it to some of the other performances from the actual Broadway shows and stuff like that, and oh my god, it's like there's no way you can't like make fun of that. It's just so it's goofy. Like I said, it's goofy.
I mean, anyone can literally
like, honestly. Because, in all seriousness, it's a bit weak, especially, like, hands down, out of all the performances on Stars, Russell Crowe's is the weakest, but still, like, you can't help but make fun of the way that he sings. It's just, you know, it's a lot of fun, and often, like, I would find myself singing different songs, like Let It Go, or anything else, sung in the same style of Russell Crowe. It's just a lot of fun.
Because anyone can literally have one facial expression and sing a song. There's no inflection or emotion. Like I said, no inflection, no emotion. Literally just all one level and just has very little change of expression on his face. Anyone can do that.
There's actually a funny thing to mention is that I saw on Facebook with all the GIFs is that one popular one is that you would see Javert looking through a window like with that blank expression. There's actually one that you would see. It's Javert. He's like, it's the same scene. Like, he looks out the window with that face, and all you see is like, it's like you see a little bit of blue, and there's like a dead fish on top.
Okay, whatever.
Hold on, I'll show you one on Facebook, and I'll send it to you. It's just too funny. But yeah, it's like, but overall, I have to say, it is a goofy, goofy film that, yeah, it really missed a lot of the notes on the original Les Mis. And keep in mind, the original Les Mis musical is a piece of beauty. Trust me, it's one of those that you know for a fact that the stage version is hands down better than the movie.
I really want to go see it.
The thing is, it's just that the movie is too goofy, man. It's too goofy to take seriously. Rather it be with Anne Hathaway's performance, Russell Crowe's performance, Eddie Redmayne's performance, Helena Bonham Carter, or Sacha Baron Cohen's performance. It's all around goofy.
Like, one, how dare you call Anne Hathaway goofy? Number two, I so want to go and see the stage version. Number three, I recommend if anyone wants to watch this film, if you want to watch it again, give yourself a good break if you end up sobbing your heart out by the end. And number four.
I just want to say, though, that I love Anne Hathaway. It's just, like, this one, yeesh.
I remember number four now. I just remembered number four. Number four was that the second time I watched this film was with my parents, and we watched it on Netflix when we first got it. And it was a case where my parents weren't a big fan of it. I think they were bored with it. And to quote them, it was like, can it get any more miserable? And this was halfway through the film. I'm like, man, it's Les Miserables. It's not going to be pink and fluffy. And also, this was the first time they actually saw me cry at a film. And they were so surprised. It's like, oh my gosh, she's actually crying. And it's like, you know, it's like, well, yeah, of course I cry at this film. It's like, because most of the time I've been like, you know, why do people cry at the film? Da, 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 da. You know, that sort of thing. But it was the first time I sort of cried at it, you know. All right, let's see what you said.
I cried three times when we first saw the movie. One, Anne Hathaway, I Dreamed a Dream. Two, when the kid gets shot. Three, at the end when Valjean dies. And me, it was me, my dad, and my mom at the theater, and we all went right, we made a beeline right to the car at the end of it, and we all jumped in, and we went right for the box of Kleenex right behind the front seat. It was, that is the type of power that this movie has for me, and the rest of it. It is one, for me, it is one very emotionally charged movie.
Mm.
And so when we sat down and watched it, Mike, I remember beforehand we were talking, he's like, I don't cry during movies.
I've never cried at a film before. But now me and Mike share the same film. That it was like the first film we ever cried at. It's like me and Mike are now connected. Really?
And I said, Mike, you're gonna cry during this movie, trust me. And so Anne Hathaway comes along. He's not crying. He's just sort of watching. And then Eponine dies. And that's when I hear Mike going,
aww. Yeah. I did. Like I said, I went to the loo because I needed the loo. And then all of a sudden, I come back. I see Mike keeled over. And he's like sobbing. It's like, enough to make your heart melt.
And I'm even telling my family about this the next day. I'm telling my folks this whole story about how Mike cried during the movie.
Yeah, I told my
you
mom
did
the next
not day. You did not.
And here's the funny thing. They were like, well, what part did he cry at? And I was like, well, he cried when Eponine died. And Mom was like, oh yes. The moment I said, when Eponine died, it was like, my mom started crying. She was like, sorry, that movie, it's just, oh my god.
I told my mom
chairs and empty tables. Now my friends are dead.
Shut up!
Yeah.
They talk
about
the revolution.
I told my mom the next day. I think her response was just like, aww.
Yeah, so it was my first time watching the movie, and I watched it with James and Steph, and I cried two times. That part, especially with Smith barks, and then Hugh Jackman at the end. But I just thought it was worth just watching one time. Like, it's a long movie, people. It's like,
yeah, it's like 2.5 hours.
I mean, I can understand why people like it. It's got good music. If they want to do this again, then, you know, just start fresh, you know, try it differently and make it shorter. That'd be pretty interesting, but it's really good. Like, but I wouldn't watch it again and again and again. If you like a good cry and like the French Revolution, it's worth a watch once at least.
I think, in a way, actually, I think this is a fact. I may be, quote me if I'm wrong, but I think I remember rightly that Les Mis is set during the July Revolutions, because a couple of people at college did Les Mis as a project.
I think it's the French Revolution. I think it's the one that caused, like, Bastille Day.
Something like that, because there's a king on the throne once again. I think it's the July Revolutions, because loads of people say, oh, it's the French Revolutions, when actually it's the July ones. I mean, a couple
so
of people did it as a college project.
Sorry to make it so wrong. I'm sorry. I get my facts wrong. It's a podcast. We don't do a lot of research. I'm doing it on top of my head. Fuck you guys. Thank you
You're
for correcting
You're supposed
me.
To do your research, Mike.
Ah.
You're supposed to be prepared. That's like watching that's like talking about a movie you haven't seen.
And I watched it. So what?
Devin, you haven't said much during this.
Well, to be honest, I didn't rewatch this movie for the podcast, so don't even ask me about performances. I honestly had no interest in seeing it again. I really, the first time I saw it, I was with my ex-boyfriend in theaters, and we watched it together. He completely hated it. He completely despised this movie. He thought it was terrible. He liked nothing about it. He thought it was too long. Like, I remember it just was such a negative vibe, I couldn't even talk about it. And I, like, part of me sort of understands why. It's too long, and it's a rock opera. I mean, that's part of the reason why I haven't rewatched it again. And I just don't like movies that are over 2 hours very much. I don't have enough patience for them. I watched the 25th anniversary, and here I found myself bored within an hour, like 2.5 hours. So, yeah, I get bored a little easily with certain types of films. So that's why I'm not talking about this movie. I just don't have anything
to do. But Javert brings in so much entertainment.
I'd rather watch Doug's NC review of it.
Yes, watch the Sasha Critics review of the movie. That's way better than watching the whole movie.
And one more little thing. Yeah.
Sure.
Number one, Devin, isn't it weird how we both saw it with, like, them boyfriends in the cinema? And number two, one of my favourite songs from Les Mis has to be On My Own. And I like how in this film it was done more with emotion than it was performance. Because usually that's a song you belt out some of those notes. But here, she didn't belt it out so much. She had that performance quality in there.
Yeah. Because I will admit, I like aspects of the musical. Here's my problem. I didn't really care for the movie. I really thought, if I want to spend 2.5 hours watching a movie, watching a rock opera, which I actually find I'm not into opera kind of musicals, I can't get into them very much. I'm actually usually asleep or bored, but I don't mind this musical on a history major front. Like, that, to me, is an interesting thing about it. It's not, I don't know, maybe for me, I'm just not into this type of musical, but it is, I will admit, though, I did cry during Anne. I remember this is the only thing I remember about the movie, is Anne Hathaway's performance of I Dreamed a Dream. That's the only thing I remember besides Russell Crowe's awful performance.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, this just wasn't for me.
Yeah.
It really wasn't.
I came home and I was just like, I put on Facebook, I was just like, just give Anne Hathaway the damn Oscar.
Miss the cynical bastard in Canada. Samantha Box's rendition of On My Own. What do we say about that?
What? Oh, were you talking to me?
Yeah, I'm talking to you. Hence, yeah. Mr. Cynical Bastard from Canada.
You know, just call cynical asshole. He'll respond back.
Okay.
Wait, what was the question?
What is your opinion on Samantha Box's rendition of On My Own? And if you say the word goofy, I will have you.
No. As I stated before, Samantha Collins' performance in general as Eponine is great. And honestly, I wasn't sure if I wanted to bring it up, considering your reaction to what I said about Anne Hathaway's performance during I Dream a Dream. But that's how I Dream a Dream should have been done, because that's the kind of song that has that grace, that tenderness into it, that also contains the sadness, the pain, and like you don't have to exaggerate it, you don't have to cry it out, you don't have to belch out your freaking lines. Like, it's nice, it's loving, it's touching, it's heartbreaking, you know? It's a really nice rendition, it's wonderful. Probably the best, one of, if not the best executed song in there. It's honestly really nice.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, Mike, that's something funny.
Because I have songs from the musical on my iPod. I love One Day More, I love On My Own.
One Day More's great. No, I love One Day More. That's why I end up doing, like, I adore One Day More so much.
One Day More.
By the way, thanks, James. I pretty much went and did my own version with characters from the Disney parks because I just wanted to.
Yes.
But yeah, it's been a while, but like it was kind of like a little passion project I wanted to do, and I was glad I did it.
I'm glad to help you out with that.
No, you did a beautiful job with it.
Yeah, I completely forgot that Victor Hugo wrote this. I was chatting with Devin the other day, and I said, now I'm picturing a Disney version with less whoring and a super happy fun ending with the schoolboys winning the battle and Javert falling off a building with possessed gargoyles. It's gonna happen. It's gonna happen now.
Disney's gonna make it all family.
Hey, come on, Johnny Bob.
It's like, ugh.
Master of the
house. Wait, what are you doing? Hey, Johnny Boy, what are you doing? You gotta let go of the girl? Yeah, what's that guy doing right there?
I believe they must be in love.
Yeah, love? Yeah, what are you talking about? Don't worry, they'll be separated.
Oh, dear.
We just need three gargoyle psychics to be a part of it.
Okay.
Isn't name is fun?
It can be for certain people.
Yeah,
who's so cynical and so heartless, you bastard.
How am I heartless? I liked Eponine.
Yeah, but the fact that you're just like,
one little aspect here. I'll even chop up the movie and give you that scene here. Take it, boom, that's it. And the rest of it's like,
we should watch the movie together.
I was gonna say, Matt's been the cynical bastard. I've just been the quiet one. I've really.
What?
I'll never watch Les Mis with Matt ever again.
What? No MST3K treatment?
Oh, I did that for the segments that it was worth.
Yeah, he did.
Oh, my God.
But yeah, when something came out, he shut up. He was like, all right, this is the time we need to quit, be quiet.
I literally said to the guys, just, I will have you if you riff the ending, you know. And luckily they did. They behaved themselves. They were good.
It was good. It was a good watch.
Watch
with friends.
You just need some training.
But I saved mine for the last because it's definitely a weird, 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 weird musical. A jukebox. Jukebox musical. A rock opera. Thank you. I'm sorry. It's a rock opera. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. I had to change my mind about that. I was like, wait, it's a rock opera. James mentioned the producer. He also produced this. He produced The Who's Tommy.
Mm-hmm.
They basically took the album of Tommy and transferred it into film, kind of like how Pink Floyd did with The Wall years later. So this came out in 1975, and... I watched it today, and dear God, it has a cohesive story, to be honest. I could actually follow the plot, more or less. Is it
intelligent, though?
No. But it's not supposed to be intelligent. If you listen to the album by The Who, it's a concept album, so you have to listen for the story, and songs go through it in and out, you know, telling a story. And they try to do that with this film, trying to incorporate the songs into a cohesive story, and it's all the music from the album. There's no talking whatsoever, it's all singing, there's no talking bits, it's all musical all the time. For about an hour and 51 minutes. Dear God, almost 2 hours long. They did
do some changes with the album and the film. They added some new stuff into the film, like new songs, not from the original album, but it kind of works out in the end. I kind of dug the music because I like The Who, so it's a great addition to the film. But the plot, the story. Mm-hmm. The story, okay. Oh, dear God, okay. Let me see if I can do this. So it starts out, I think it takes place like after World War II, I believe, because I think the concept album takes place after World War I, so that's the difference between the album and the film. It takes place after World War II, or during, because Tommy's mother and father, they were during the war. She met up with him. He's a cockfighter in the war. He dies, but she has a baby, and his name is Tommy. On the day that they declare peace after the war, oh, it's the boy, it's the boy, it's the boy. It's just, I don't know, I can't, it's just, it.
And it's, the husband disappears because they think he's dead.
That's, I thought he was dead. I was watching the movie. I thought the father was dead. They showed him, like, after they cut away from the birth of Tommy, they cut away to, like, a funeral. And they show Tommy a little bit older as a kid. I'm thinking, did it take that long to do, a memorial service for everybody who died? I was like, Jesus Christ, it took, like, a couple of years for that to happen. And then there's that scene where... There's a scene where Tommy and his mother go to a holiday camp. I think the character's name is Bernie, so it's Bernie's holiday camp. And she meets Bernie, the camp owner, and they fall in love. So Tommy has a stepfather now. And they go back home. They start, the mother and the stepfather start to screw around a bit, and all of a sudden, the father shows up, and I thought it was a ghost. I thought he was a ghost that came out of nowhere, came into the room, seen Tommy, and then go to their room, and then I'm like, then I saw Tommy go into the room, and you see the stepfather and stepfather hit the father in the head with a lamp, and he's passed out on the ground. I was like, what the fuck's going on here? I thought he was dead. Why is he alive? And it just really fucked up in my head.
Kill him again.
But here's the weird thing that gets really weird. Tommy was born normal. He wasn't deaf, dumb, or blind.
For a kid.
He was a normal kid. So, I don't know how this happens, but the parents, the mother and the stepfather was like, you didn't see nothing, you didn't hear nothing, you didn't see anything at all. And all of a sudden, this traumatic moment in his life made him deaf, dumb, and blind. Like something snapped.
Like a somatic blindness.
Yes, thank you. That's the term I was looking for. It was described in the plot, too. It was like something happened and boom, he is deaf, dumb, and blind now. And so you see this whole sequence of Tommy, you know, like they segue to a Christmas party, and he's in his little toy convertible, and he's like just staring there blankly. He's blind, and he's deaf, and he's like, "Can you hear me, Tommy? Can you hear me, Tommy?" And it actually, you kind of hear inside, like there's like an inner monologue that says, "Feel me, touch me, heal me." And that's like Tommy saying, feel me, touch me, heal me. And it was like, it's throughout the whole movie, but this movie gets even weirder. Like, mm-hmm. you see Tommy grow up. So he goes into, mind you, the cast is basically comprised of The Who. Like, I think Roger Daltrey plays Tommy. I'm trying to remember offhand. Keith Moon plays like the uncle. Oh my god, the cousin and uncle scenes. Oh my god, there's It's kind of ahead of the other point. There's like there's a scene, there's another scene. There's a scene up ahead of the movie where the parents go out and Tommy's like, the parent mother's like, are you sure you we'd leave Tommy alone with his cousin? And then it was like, I think he's fine. And the cousin almost kills him, or tries to kill him, like, does everything, like, drown him, suffocate him, beat the shit out of him, like, spray him with a fire hose, like, he's beating the shit out of Tommy. I'm like, what the fuck's going on? And then there's the uncle scene, who's played by Keith Moon, and it just keeps weirder and weirder. It's just like, I don't even remember the uncle scene, but I just, like, thought that was weird. But a scene before that was her mom and her stepfather, and the stepfather try to cure him every which way possible. And one of the ways, is the first ways they do it is there's a cult wedding thing with Aaron Clapton.
The statue of Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, with Aaron Clapton being the priest of this, he's doing a song for this, and it's a really good song actually in the film. And it's a cult of Marilyn Monroe. Like, there's females with masks of Marilyn, and then there's this huge statue that they, like, all the people kiss her feet at, and then all the crippled or handicapped or mentally disabled people touch it as they walk, get strolled by. And I was like, what the fuck is this? And it's like, what, Marilyn Monroe? Is this? And so they go last, and she's forcing Tommy to kiss the feet, like, kiss it, you'll be cured. Knocks the statue over, smashed to the pieces.
Doesn't work. Move on. No,
doesn't work. Move on. So
So what should we try? So what should we try if Marilyn Monroe's beauty doesn't work? Why not inject him full of acid?
Yes, thank you. Yes, James, just keep moving because I'm trying to remember. So you have Tina Turner coming in to help cure him. She's the gypsy. She's the acid queen. And she's psychotic. She is so psychotic in this.
She sticks him in an Iron Maiden with needles.
Yes.
With syringes.
Yes. Yeah, and it goes like really psychedelic with it too a bit. And there's a bit where they're trying to like see his process through the thing, and there's a point where he looks like his father, his real father. And then he goes back to his self, and that's, oh God, Tina Turner. I mean, God dang, she's so psychotic. But there was a, I don't know if I'm jumping ahead, but there's a scene where Tommy starts like he keeps staring at the mirror. I think that's the common theme, is like looking into the mirror a lot. That's one of the themes of the film. He just looks in the mirror. I guess he follows his reflection into the junkyard, and he discovers the pinball machine. And the parents get all freaked out. The cops are like, hey, there's a pinball machine. And then they're like, oh, gosh, he's good at pinball. And then you get the pinball wizard scene with Elton John. In it.
Who's wearing giant clown shoes.
Huge.
Life-size clown shoes. When they were putting this movie together, were they just... When they put the story together, were they just throwing darts at a newspaper?
Well, okay, so... Here's a little fun fact for you. Stevie Wonder wanted to play the pinball wizard part that Elton John played, that character in particular. And they're like, Stevie, the character is meant to be not blind. He can see. He's competing against Tommy, so that's why we couldn't cast you. And he was like, he was angry about it.
Goddamn! Why don't you make him blind? That can't blind too, but I'll be blind too. Goddamn!
Gets even so weirder. Yeah,
because of his pinball wizardry as this dumb, deaf, and blind guy, he becomes so popular, so famous, that the mother and the stepfather become rich off it. They get a new mansion, they get jewelry, they get cars, they're on yachts, they're rich because of Tommy. And
they get a bean company that wants to sponsor him.
It could be interpreted that way, but the way I was watching it, the mother was watching TV, and I was reading kind of into the film a little bit more, that the director, I believe, was poking fun at the TV a little bit, because the bean, and I believe it was related to soap, he was kind of spoofing that or saying hot, because he did commercials back in the day, directing commercials, and it's like this is his big comeback against the commercials, like so the beans were, because that commercial he's seen with the beans fit for a queen, that was like a spoof of one of the commercials he made back in the day. So I was like watching the bean commercial, so weird.
The TV starts spewing out beans, and the mom is swimming.
So
in them,
the scene is her having a nervous breakdown, and she just had to do whatever. So it starts spraying out soap, it starts spraying out beans, and it starts spraying out chocolate, and she's like rolling around in it, just so crazy. And the stepfather Bernie comes in. Just like, he's like, see, well, what the fuck is she on? Like, nothing, you don't see anything around her. But just moves on from that. But fun fact, while filming, she actually cut herself from the TV while doing that. And they had to go to the hospital to get her stitches during that scene. Kind of sucked.
Really fun.
Not really fun at all. I'm trying to think now.
How does he get cured again?
I don't know.
Remember how he got cured?
Okay. Yes. I remember this one in particular. It's a really... there's a connection to the mirror. There's a connection to a mirror, and he keeps looking at the mirror. Well, I totally skipped over the fact that Jack Nicholson plays a part as, like, the doctor that kind of diagnoses, trying to cure him. Through all of this goofy technology, Jack Nicholson comes in. I don't think he sings. I think he was dubbed in, I believe. I think I read that. But after Jack Nicholson says there, he can see but cannot comprehend or something. He can hear you but cannot relay the message to you. He can speak but something like that. And then her mother realizes, okay, only the one way to do it, just push it right through the mirror, which I don't know what the mirror does, but the mirror pushes him out into the freaking ocean of all places, and he's like, he can see again, the sun's in his eyes, like, and he can swim, and that's where the song I'm Free comes in. I'm free, I'm free, I'm free from metal. He's cured. And then, okay, this is where it gets really confusing, because the rest of the film, he becomes this religious cult icon. Like, it's I guess he's the miracle boy. I guess when he's cured, and everybody looks up to him now, and it's like, and it goes into showing this girl, this little girl. I think her name is Sally in the film, and she's obsessed with him. She's obsessed with them. Her whole room is like wallpapered with Tommy, and it's so freaking weird. It's She ends up going to the little girl goes up to, because her father's like, oh, you can't go, no. And she's like, fuck this, I'm gonna go without my father's permission. She goes to one of the cult quote church sessions. She's up in the front row, she's all pretty, just ready to meet Tommy, because they're worlds apart, you know, they're connected somehow, but they're worlds apart. And shit happens to her, because she's trying to squeeze through, like, the police were there trying to back up the crowds, like, she's trying to squeeze in, and then she tries to get up to the stage, and the stepfather just, like, stepped on her fingers, and she fell backwards and gushed her face on a chair, so that she gets pulled away from all while, she had to get stitches, and then she ends up marrying this rocker who looks like Frankenstein, and she...
I don't even remember that. I mean, wow.
And she's dressed up all fancy, and she has a kid, too, even though she's, like, 12 as well, so it's like the rock... It was so fucking weird that whole sequence with the girl. I was like, what the hell's... I mean, I can tell with the song, but it just feels like it's... And then, like I said, it ends, and towards the end, I believe, Tommy has his own holiday camp. I guess at the beginning, too, if there's a little foreshadowing that Tommy wanted to have his own holiday camp like the stepfather did. So it came true. He has a holiday camp now. And now it's, like, all based on Tommy, and it's, like, merchandise. It's, like, when you walk into the camp, here, you can have the T-shirt, have the merchandise, T-shirt. You know, get your sunglasses, get your...
Tommy the Flamethrower! The kids love that one.
Mm-hmm. It's like everything is like get pushed in. It's like you gotta pay up. It costs £3. Cha-ching! Thank you. Have a nice day. And I guess it's funny because they're like there, and then Tommy's like, "Hey, you drinker, you boozer, you do not do this when you're here." And then goes by a smoker. "Hey, man, don't smoke this. This is not what you need. What you need in life is pinball. You need a life as pinball." And it's like they give them the experience of being a pinball wizard by having the sunglasses, the earbuds, and then the cork for the mouth. There's like a cork for the mouth, and I did not understand why there was a cork for the mouth. It's like not to talk, I guess, while playing pinball, I guess. So they're playing pinball, and then they just get everybody at the camp is like, all right, fuck this. We're not going to take it anymore. They start smashing the pinball machines and just beat the shit out of the parents. Tommy, spoiler alert, sorry, should have said that a long time ago. They beat the crap out of the parents. They're dead. Tommy's, like, beaten up, and he ends up just climbing a mountain afterwards and just singing one last song, and then a movie ends. It just...
Hey...
This, I mean, I kind of liked it because it was just so batshit crazy with what it's going for. The music was great because I love The Who and the album's pretty great. But, I mean, the imagery alone is just fuck, like, screws you up big time.
The story and the characters, I did not like them. I remember watching this, and even as far as the musical performances, this is where I'm gonna be the bastard and say I didn't like the music. I mean, I like when The Who was doing the song Pinball Wizard on their original concept album. That's it about this. Elton John butchering Pinball Wizard as a song, that to me was blasphemy right there. I understand the problem here is not that I don't understand the story or what's going on. The problem is I understand too much of what's going on, and none of it makes sense from point A to point B, character motivations and whatnot. where is an inkling of sanity in this world? It's not even very funny. It's just trying to be trippy. What is it trying to say? What is the message? I don't get it.
Yeah, I was like totally like lost. I mean, I was like thinking, what was? I mean, you're trying to see, and I kind of know why they don't do this anymore, because it's hard to take concept album and transfer it to film. There's going to be changes no matter what, but then it's just like, how do you transfer songs into a film? It's like, because it's a freaking story about a deaf, dumb, and blind kid becoming a pinball wizard and then some other crap and how he becomes cured of his blindness and deafness and his smartness, I guess, gets smarter. Like, I can understand the meaning of it, because the Who is pretty big. But it's like, the Pink Floyd's The Wall, years later, had a better concept. Like, it has at least a somewhat of decent story you can follow. Like, you understand what the meanings are. There's a lot of messages going for the Wall, but with Tommy, there's no point to it. Like, it's just a dumb, deaf, and very blind when it comes to a story.
How ironic. Yeah, I try to say that myself with all due respect, you know, looking back on it, what was popular about this? What was so appealing about this? And the people that I'd spoken to about it, they said, well, you had to be there in the 60s and the 70s to really understand the pull of it at the time. And I guess I don't miss it.
I mean, if you're going to go by reviewer semantics, I mean, I'm going to mention Rotten Tomatoes, of course, which I don't think everybody likes it, but I'm going to say it holds 76% on Rotten Tomatoes, and Roger Ebert, all people, gave it 3 out of 4 stars. So he praised the acting from Tommy's mother, who's played by Anne Margaret, if you're wondering. Anne Margaret is very well known in acting. She's, for those recent people who, not recent people, but people who have seen Grumpy Men or Grumpy Old Men, she's the lady in those films, just the comparison's sake. Roger Ebert said he also called the pinball tournament sequence the movie's best single scene, a pulsating orgasmic turn-on edited with precision of a machine gun blast. I mean, that scene was just... I don't know, Ebert, that kind of... But then, the best thing of all on Wikipedia here, they mention Old Dirty Bastard. He said, oh, Tommy was a great film.
Oh, who's Old Dirty Bastard?
He's a rapper.
An old dirty bastard.
He says a blind deaf kid who can play pinball. What a very good idea. I mean, it's just like, I like the music. The music's amazing. Like, it's a great rock opera. It, like, you can close your eyes and just listen to the music. It's fine. Just listen to the soundtrack. It's nice. Like, I like this little songs they added in, like, you know, they did the, there's like extra, you know, extra, Tommy can speak now. You know, it's just like those little things. And the mother was really good in it, actually. I was like, that was really good. There's some solid acting in it. Like, they had to sing, and I guess they had to, like, dub
I think, because I don't think it was live singing. It was just like they sang in the studio first, and then they dubbed all their lines, mimicking it as they were acting. So I was just like, I'm watching, and I was like, oh my god, it's in sync really well. It's like, wow, is. I mean, this is a film I could watch a couple of times here and there. I mean, I'm the Who. I'm a big Who fan, so.
Oliver Reed's voice was the worst.
Yeah, Oliver Reed plays Bernie, yeah.
I think Oliver Reed was a terrific actor. His Bill Sykes performance in Oliver was always I always felt like he became that role that was perfect for him. That's what I'll always remember him for. But even in Oliver, they cut out Bill Sykes' song from the play, and I think I now know why, because in Tommy, you listen to Oliver Reed singing and he can't do it. Matt, you were complaining about Russell Crowe. You will have no complaints about anything.
I don't have any complaints about Russell Crowe. I love Russell Crowe. It's just, like, so bad it's good.
Well, what, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You know what I mean. You listen to Oliver Reed sing, he can't do it. I'm sorry.
It's, like, so bad it's bad.
Yeah. You could call me Uncle Frank.
You can call me Uncle Frank. Yeah. It's
at least Russell Crowe has vibrato.
Like, I think this would be like a really good film if I could find a good copy to watch as a screening, because it would be so riffable. It's unbelievable. It's a real acid trip to watch it, because, like I said, it's just very.
Well, it misses too if you try.
a good glug of alcohol, maybe.
It's a little bit shorter than Les Mis. I mean, it's clocks under 2 hours, so it's just like, it's a worth.
I'll watch Les Mis with alcohol. That's a good idea.
It's an improvement on anything.
Yeah, it's just with. Oh, God, with musicals in general, it's just like there's tons to talk about. There's just jukebox musicals, there's rock operas, there's movies that are based on Broadway musicals, there's so much more. And maybe there could be a possibility we revisit this again in the future. There's so many to talk about. We love our musicals. Awesome. We do. In another 3 years, maybe. I don't know. It depends on what throwback I can go for topics again. But other than that.
Just me, isn't it?
I can hear it too, don't worry, you're not going insane. Okay. Alright.
Oh.
Is this a hint?
Next month we're going to do some Halloween topics again. We're going to do Halloween month. Halloween month for October, some scary topics. Next time, we're going to talk about zombie films. Go into the creepy, crawly.
Can I just quickly say, technically for me, it's already the 1st of October, so pinch and a punch for the 1st of the month, No Return White Rabbits. Woo!
Nah.
Hooray.
Halloween season doesn't begin for me until October 6th.
Well,
I need my me time first, and then suddenly pop out like freaking Jack Skellington.
Yay. There you
go. Well, I've already preloaded my Halloween playlist onto here, so I got it wherever I go. I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
Can you dig it? Thank you for watching this long, 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 long episode of Cinema Royale. What is your favorite musical? Please leave a comment below. What's your least favorite? What do you think about all the movies we talked about? Leave a comment below. I'll check them out. Maybe I'll give you a shout out in the next one. Who knows? I think just subscribe to my channel for more podcasts. We got lots more coming this year. Lots to go through for season 4, season 5 next year. And I got a couple more videos planned out, but it's college is being a bitch right now for me. So until next time, this has been Cinema Royale. See you later, dudes.
And I'm Jemma!
I've lost my mind.
Do not forget our name. We are Cinema Royale.
24601.
And peace.
No, wait, no, I can't do this.
Let's not do the hopeless story. Can we start from the base?
I just already whacked him. Let's just whack him.
One day more to evolution. We run the band in the pod. We'll be ready for these schoolboys. They will wet themselves with blood. Jumba!
I haven't even said goodbye yet, and it's
all crap.
Ciao for now.
Die dramatic!